Hey. I call it, oh yeah. Your bumper is a magnet. I stick on like a magnet. A magnet.
Yeah, it's magnetic. Join Sarojini on Caribbean Connections, Thursdays at 1. Walk through the sands with poetry from our great leaders and academics. Jive with us to soca, reggae, chutney, and calypso. Get your current cricket results, meet special guests, and more. Every Thursday, 11:30 Eastern, 1 p.m. Newfoundland time.
Run it! This one I hit, yeah, yo. Lady Sarojini.
Bless up, everyone. This is Trident Ben from Jamaica here representing, for the most, the host, Lady Sarojini, with the Caribbean Connection Show. Hey, Pangwa, 93.5 FM, CHMR, 11.
Pardon me, I'm a non-criminal, so get on your certain. But let me tell you, though, if you never know, I'm an island man with an African culture. No drugs, no yin, I'm a bad.
When we dancing, hey, you are my king, I'm your queen. We don't let nobody in, nobody in, nobody in between.
Live from Toronto, this is DJ Eruption. You're listening to Sarojini from Caribbean Connections. Peace out.
Then you hold my bumper and grind.
Hello, hello, and good afternoon. Welcome to Caribbean Connections, and I am your host, Sarojini, coming to you on this glorious day. I want to thank you all for listening here on the island of Newfoundland and Labrador, our friends and family in Toronto, Winnipeg, Regina, Saskatoon, Calgary, Vancouver, and those of you on the Sunshine Coast in British Columbia, Roberts Creek and Maple Ridge, crossing over to New York, Connecticut, Washington, D.C., Berlin, Germany, Nigeria, Zimbabwe, and of course, my Caribbean peeps in Guyana, Jamaica, Trinidad and Tobago, Belize, the Bahamas, and to all of you listening from far and wide, welcome, welcome, welcome. Today on the program, we continue our Black History Month celebrations. Today is the fourth of a four-part series. And on the program today, we have Chef Michael Collins. But before we go any further, let's give it up for One Love, People Get Ready by the one and only Bob Marley.
Let's
today on Caribbean Connections, we are very honored to be interviewing Chef Michael Collins. Today is the last of a four-part series on our annual Black History Month celebrations. Michael Collins is a Caribbean-influenced chef with over 6 years of experience working in high-end restaurants. His mission is to excel by adding creativity, the finest quality of ingredients, and a flawless workflow. Michael's new restaurant, Caribbean Corner, features Caribbean dishes enhanced by culinary influences from Africa, India, the Middle East, and Europe. It is a feast for all the senses, meant to excite not just the palate, but the eyes and nose as well. So we're going to hear it now from the man himself, Chef Michael Collins, and we're going to hear all about how to experience not just a meal, but a social and gastronomical experience of a lifetime. Good afternoon, Michael, and welcome to Caribbean Connections. How are you today?
Oh, I'm doing great. Everything is wonderful today. It's nice. Wake up another day happy, healthy, and everything is really blessed.
That is important. You wake up healthy, right? And happy. And I know you worked last night too, so that was a busy night for you.
Yeah, because usually like on weekends we close like around like 4 a.m. So it's like a lot of like cleaning up, packing away, and making sure the place is tidy.
Wow. So you don't get home till like 5:30?
Yeah. So it's a lot.
It's a lot. Well, you know, I want to thank you for coming on the program today. I know you have a busy schedule, and we are just thrilled to have you take some time off and for you to tell your story and to share your experiences, not only for the Black community in Newfoundland and Labrador, but for all people in Newfoundland and Labrador to hear your story. So I like to ask these questions because a lot of people, they're curious, you know. I know you came to Canada 8 years ago from San Fernando and the beautiful island of Trinidad and Tobago, where I happened to visit also, and I loved it. Give us a little glimpse into what it was like growing up in Trinidad and Tobago.
So growing up in a Caribbean island, so based upon my traveling in different places around the world, see that is like more freedom. Like going from a Caribbean island, like they have like a lot of values and morals and stuff, and a code of conduct that we have to like go by. So that's pretty much how I was raised. I was raised like just being kind, polite, manners, you know, and because what adults and stuff throughout generations, they want the best for their children. So I grew up in a positive and that ambitious mindset, which I'm really thankful for, and have that opportunity to, you know, live through that in my life. But the Caribbean is a relaxing place. It's colorful. It's vivid. Food-wise, too, it's very diverse because, like, at the same time, we have, like back in the days, we had, like, people from Europe, India, Africa migrating to the Caribbean and then bringing their culture, their foods and stuff. And we gain all these different flavors, all these different type of cultures. So we're very like broad in diversity. So I'll say the Caribbean is just like one place where everybody from around the world belongs, you know, and we all get along together really well.
Yeah, and actually, we're going to delve into that diverse backgrounds of people as we talk about your cuisine, because that is it plays a very important role in the cuisine of the Caribbean as well. So we'll talk more about that when we get to the cooking part of the show. But when you came here, though, you said to me earlier, it was like a culture shock, because you had never come to Newfoundland before, and this was your first time. So just a little bit about how you adjusted and how you felt at that time when you came.
Well, first time arriving in Newfoundland, like, I wasn't prepared for the weather. Because, like, I'm really not used to coming here, like, in the fall. Like, we don't have, like, much seasons back home. We only have rain and just hot sun, pretty much. But here, experiencing, like, all the different types of, like, weather, like, spring, the fall, winter, and summer. It's really, like, shocking to see. But at the same time, just, like, living here, like, throughout the years and stuff, like, I overcome it and just got used to it. And coming into Newfoundland was quite the experience because I did not know this place existed, to be honest.
Really? But you, and that leads me to the next thing. You knew about it because you were attending UWI and there were recruiters there, am I correct? And they were recruiting for Memorial.
Yes. So that's the only way, like, I knew that Newfoundland was a place. So basically they came down and they showed us the programs and what they're offering, like different types of courses. So my brother and I, like, we decided, like, to do engineering out here. Mm-hmm. And then off and doing, like, geology, and then I ventured off and doing, like, business.
Wonderful. So your brother is still here with you?
Yes. Yeah, yes. He's working out central for Newfoundland Gold.
Mm-hmm.
That's just a big process. It's, especially me working in the field too, we found, like, a lot of gold that could generate, like, a lot of jobs, boost up the economy and all that stuff here in Newfoundland.
Mm-hmm. You said you worked for about 2 years with a mining company. You were also a promoter in St. John. So what did you do promoting? Or what did you promote, rather?
Yeah, so on the promoting aspect, what I used to do is, like, the thing is, coming here for, like, for the first time now, like, I didn't see much diversity. And so I decided, like, to, yeah, so basically, like, my first time here in Newfoundland, I didn't really notice much diversity in the nightlife. So, like, international students at that time, well, throughout my age at that time, you'll usually go to, like, house parties, play, like, our own type of music, and, like, either Latin, indie, or whatever it is.
Yeah, some reggae, soca, calypso too, all of that.
So now, like, I just made this decision just to, like, book a venue and fly down some international DJs that would play these type of music for everybody, right? So one night, my first event at dusk was the greatest experience ever. I had people from around the world in one night, which was really overwhelming because I felt pull it off. And a lot of people that I just supported have seen something different, something new, vivid, you know, and energetic, and the cultures bond when you host these type of events and stuff. You get to know people from around the world, get to know the experiences, the history, and all that stuff, right?
Mm-hmm.
It's like a, how do you call it? It's like a pot, like, mixed up with all these, like, different...
A melting pot, yeah. Yeah. So these are not only university students from around the world, but people within the community as well that came out to the event.
Yeah, so, like, the locals as well, they never had that experience before. And so it was, like, very, like, you know, it was really fun for them and stuff, for them to experience.
Oh, yeah. Well, you know, the stats show that Memorial has students, and this is stats from 3 years ago, students from over 300 different countries. Can you imagine that? Over 300 different countries. So I mean, that is very impactful when you have an event and you've got people from all these communities coming together, right? So I want to ask you, and I know a lot of our listeners are probably wondering, how did you get into cooking? Because we want to talk about cooking today. I know you finished school, you graduated, right? You did some other stuff. You did your mining job, you did your promoting, and you had several jobs. So now you decided to really delve into cooking. So tell us how it all started.
Well, it started off in 2016 when I was working in the deli department at Sobeys. One of my friends, her name is Melissa, she offered me a job to work on a kitchen line at Finn McCool's. And from there, I had no a kitchen experience, but she like guided me and trained me and like teach me like small things. I ventured off to Boca Tapas Bar, and that's where I gained all experience from cooking. Boca, like, you have everything that, I just can't explain, like, how much love this man has shown me in the cooking industry and always guided me and mentors me. And it's really great. And then I ventured off with Mike Clark. He's a man. Science behind the cooking, you know, he's on top. All these, both these guys who I work with, genuinely like amazing people. And from there, I like in caterings and experiencing things on my own. And, and that's how I took the cooking to another level pretty much with their lectures and.
Yes, and I actually were at my husband and I were at Boca, pardon me, one night. I was like a reggae night event, and you cooked that night there, so I was able to sample some of your cooking.
Oh, I
Yeah,
forgot about
that was a long time ago. I think that was like 2019.
that. That was a long time
Yeah,
ago.
it's almost 4 years ago. My goodness, Michael, don't tell me it was that long. Wow. But before that, you told me your mother and grandmother, you were always amazed at how they cooked, and you were influenced by all of that. Am I correct?
Yes, because every morning, like my grandmother would wake up like at 5 a.m. just to make sure like all of us had like breakfast and everything she touched, I don't know what it is, it was just like magically delicious. Making like rotis in the morning, fried bake, different types of like Caribbean cuisines, and my mom as well too. My dad, he's more like the barbecue master. He likes to barbecue a lot of stuff, which is tasty, like no complaints. And I learned like throughout like living in a household, like we're all like kind of like grew up together, all of us, my grandparents, uncles, everybody. And I learned like different skills from each one of them who cooked. And it was very tasty. So like I wanted to bring that to Newfoundland for everybody to try. So like every after party, perhaps to say, I'll have like a gathering of people and just like it cook for them out of my heart and for people to experience like something different and no complaints yet. And really cool that I gained all these like skills.
Yeah. So did you feel back then you really wanted to cook and you loved it a lot? You would have been quite young back then when you saw all of this.
Yeah, to be honest, I was just focusing more on like mechanical engineering because like I grew up in say in an environment of like racing performance, anything that has to do with an engine, because my uncles and my dad, they're engineers, so it was around a lot of engines and stuff. So I was like into cars and racing and all that stuff. But then I came here and I just opened my up some my eyes open up and for cooking. And I don't know, I just ventured off from there, and so far so good.
Yeah, I know, and now here you are. You have a new restaurant called Caribbean Corner right on Water Street, 302 Water Street, and you just opened it. So how do you feel now that this dream of yours has finally come to fruition? What's the feeling?
I was nervous, to be honest, because like I never had the opportunity to, like to, well, be in the position of you know, the face of the business. It's very overwhelming in the beginning. When I first opened up, I had like a lot of love and support from the community. And I really very thankful for every one of these guys who like supported the business coming back. But owning and operating a business like has like challenges and like a little bit of conflicts that involve financing, permits and all that stuff. And it's a really challenging pathway to take, because you have to be on your toes every day. You have to be up all night making sure that everything is covered and everything is ready to go. You cannot make any mistakes when like operating a restaurant, because like you can lose everything just like this. Tired, drain, making sure everything is like taken care of. But so far, so good. Really happy, like, you know, that this dream happened.
Yes, and you seem to have had a really good support network. And, you know, this is where working in several places and your promoting experience probably came into handy to your benefit, because you would have able to tap into everyone to let them know about this restaurant. And, you know, in this town, word of mouth is so important. Someone you know who knows someone, they believe you. So did you find that was really the case?
That was, yes, just like being, just by being a promoter, like I networked with so many amazing people and, and they had my support. They're recommending and referring to other people that to come to my restaurant and try like something different. And so far, like I have like not great amount of people just like coming in or ordering online and stuff. Really great.
Yes. Yeah. And we're going to get in more into like all the details about ordering and so, so our listeners will definitely be able to tap into the restaurant. You mentioned that you're a Caribbean influence chef with over 4 years of experience working at high-end restaurants, and these skills have shaped you into the chef you are today. Now, you also stated that your mission is to excel by adding creativity, the finest ingredients, and a flawless workflow to the mix. I'd like you to tell us more about all of this and how you feel this will shape your restaurant.
Well, compared to like most to like most like restaurants and stuff like that, and as not to talk about anybody and stuff like that, but you see the thing is all like corporate restaurants and stuff, they keep doing like repetitive stuff over and over, and they don't get cooks opportunities to explore and expand. That's why we're a chef with Gregory and Mike Clark. They gave me opportunities to bring things to the menu, be creative, and that's how I gained my own knowledge into cooking and like putting the science behind it, learning different ingredients, how to plate, how to craft, and all that stuff. Now you see like these the corporate franchises or whatever, they keep doing same robotic movements over and over, and it doesn't allow anybody to be artistic, you know, be creative and stuff. So me, on the other hand, like for my restaurant personally or my catering service, I love to be creative. I just don't want to be doing like the same thing over and over again, because I want to learn more. I don't want to learn different things. And as you mentioned, like I want to excel. I don't want to be here. I want to be up here as always.
Yes, next level, as you said, right? Absolutely, yeah.
So then coming up with like creative recipes, creative ideas, and not just by myself, people who I interact and socialize with as well, they give me like these crazy ideas and stuff, right? Even though they do not know how to cook, they have like the idea behind them, and I don't tell them like what to do if they actually want to go in this type of business and stuff. I like to guide people and show them, you know, I teach them as well in things in cooking. And me personally, like I love just, you know, being a teacher as well. And you know, I don't have nothing to hide. I'll share everything with everybody. Like everybody needs to learn, right? Because at the end of the day, like all my knowledge is not going, you know, with me when I die and stuff. So I just want to share as much as I can.
Yeah.
That's my mindset. I want to take care of the community and stuff. Mm-hmm. So if it be like, they got it.
Yes. And I think right now there might still be one more, but as of now, I think you might be the only Caribbean restaurant in town.
Yes, that's based upon my research. Yeah, the only Caribbean restaurant on Water Street. It's crazy.
Yeah.
You brought that up. That's crazy.
Yeah, think of that, like how impactful it is. I mean, in all of Canada and in our little town or city in the province of Newfoundland and Labrador, you have the only Caribbean restaurant. And that says a lot.
That's quite a lot, yeah.
Yeah.
It's really something different, you know. And as I said before, like most of the restaurants, like they kind of do repetitive stuff.
Mm-hmm.
With the promoting, I was just telling you how they're doing like repetitive stuff, but not bringing in no diversity, right? So that's where I came into play.
Yes, and speaking of diversity, it has been stated that colorful is one word to describe the culture of the Caribbean people. And we talked about this, that the region is a melting pot of different languages, cuisine, music, and customs. And you and I both know Caribbean cuisine consists of culinary influences from Africa, France, Spain, India, Dutch, Holland, America, Britain, the Middle East, and Asia. How do you feel about this big mix of culture and, as it states, a melting pot in your kitchen? And how do you hope to bring that into your food?
I feel actually really great and comfortable, like having diverse menu items on the menu, because I don't want to be like secluded to just what people might say Caribbean food, like jerk chicken, for instance. Because like a lot of people, they think that just because like I have a Caribbean restaurant, I'm just going to sell jerk chicken. No, we are, as I like, we had like a lot of immigrations from people that are around the world, and they brought their cuisines with them. Mm-hmm. And so my target is to make sure that every possible dish from around the world is there. And as you mentioned before, like I have I know Dutch recipes, I know Indian recipes, I know recipes and stuff, because we have all that, you know, in the Caribbean. And I want to make it as much diverse as I can, just for everybody to feel like they're eating at home.
Yeah. Absolutely. So on that good note, what are some of the dishes? You don't have to say all, but what are some of the dishes on the menu? Maybe some of the popular ones you can tell us.
Yeah, well, our number one, the top seller is oxtail.
All right.
It is like, it's based, mainly like really popular in Jamaica. We braise the meat for like 3 to 5 hours, making sure like the meat falls off from the bone and it's really rich and juicy. So it's some rice, mashed potatoes, a coleslaw with a side of hot sauce, and it's like really delicious. That's our top seller. Every time we put it out, it sells.
Oh my, you're making me hungry, my God. And I just had a little toast with peanut butter just now. So I'm ready for oxtail. What else is your best seller at the restaurant?
Next one will be like the jerk chicken, because everybody knows that's a popular dish in Jamaica.
Oh, yeah. Absolutely.
Cut, which is another popular dish. I had like the peri peri chicken, which is a dish that's influencing like it's created in Portugal, but it's influenced like in many places in Africa. So I put that there. That's another top seller. Then we have gyros. We have beef, and we have pork lamb gyros.
Mm-hmm. And
we have the curry lobster. You know, that's another one.
Wow! Did you say curry lobster? Yeah, well, yeah. I'll tell you, I've had like curry fish of different kinds, but never curried lobster. My Michael, that is really venturing into uncharted territory.
The most important one that we have so far is like we have our Jamaican patties. We have beef, duck, and veggie patties. And those are our top sellers too. People buy that by the bulk. It's
Oh
crazy.
my, and you make it right at the restaurant. There's nothing like ordering it and heating it up. This is made right there. Oh my gosh, wow. How about like roti dishes and curry dishes? You have those as well there?
Yes, so we have goat roti, beef roti, chicken roti, shrimp roti. We have lamb roti too. Let me see the type of roti. No, yeah, that's how. And we have like the vegetarian roti as well. It's just
Yes.
potatoes.
And these are all offered daily, or do you have certain days where you have like the specials, like Monday to Saturday, or they're offered every day of the week?
Yeah, so we offer all those menu items every day, except well from like 2:30 to like 3:30, it's just like we're serving only patties because we're just of the night because like those dishes are like very hefty and like very time consuming to just make and just have.
Yes.
So we just like change the late night menus to just like vegetarian or beef duck patties.
Well, how much staff do you have at the restaurant right now?
Two.
Wow, so you two are working very hard, and I imagine you're one of the chefs there, of course.
Yeah, so it's myself, my business partner, and one other co-worker. He's my sous chef, and he like just 3 of us, we just pulled away because like it's a winter right now, and so most restaurants here they're like they really like slow down and stuff. It's not like the summertime where it's like booming where you need more staff. So just the cost and all that stuff, which is really important because we don't want to do any type of mistakes and to make the business fail. So we're just doing like what's best, you know.
Yes, and you sent me a little clip of something that I read, and it said food in the Caribbean is a social activity, strengthening the familial bonds and keeping your tummies nourished. Don't you agree with that when it comes to your restaurant?
Yeah, so like when I have like people like it coming over, everybody laughing, socializing, and talking about how great the food is. And it's like, and I said before, like the Caribbean is like a warm place where we love to include everybody. So when people they come to my restaurant, even strangers too, who just start socializing, that's how comfortable like they feel just being there. And that's what I want to show as a Caribbean, like coming from the Caribbean. I want everybody to feel as one, that we're all united.
Exactly. And is it a dine-in as well, or only take out?
It's mainly takeout, but we have like a limited amount of seats, probably like we could seat probably over like 6 people because we as a takeout business.
Absolutely. And over time, I guess you will see how it goes with the restaurant for dining, right?
Yeah. I'll have to expand how just like I'll figure things out in the future, but for right now I just want to push like takeout and just waiting 2 more months, just waiting for the summertime to kick in.
Oh yeah, I think we all can't wait for summer, you know. And I also read from the little clip you sent to me that some of us know that Caribbean cuisine has distinctly flavored spices and condiments. It's a feast for all the senses, meant to excite not just the palate, but the eyes and the nose. So if I come into your restaurant, I'm going to get this experience, right?
Yes, and everybody said the same thing.
Wonderful. So, Michael, tell us again the hours of operation for the business and your address, your location.
So the hours of operations, we start from 3 p.m. to 11 p.m. from Mondays to Thursdays.
And on weekends, 3 p.m. until like 3:30 a.m. So we have late nights. So anybody on George Street, you know, they could pop by and come and grab a bite to eat, you know, before they head downtown, if they before they head back home, if they're hungry and stuff.
Yeah.
So yeah, so we are located at 302 Water Street. 302 Water Street is like, it's where the old Mickey sandwiches used to be. It's next, right next to Celtic Heart, and behind, we're behind George Street.
Great, great. Yeah. Now, your phone number, if someone wants to call in for an order, give us a phone number. And do you have a website or something where do they place the order online, or do you always call it in?
Basically, so right now I'm working on a website. Like today, I'm sending all the information and like photos that they're required for me. So I'm going to have that done. People can place orders through Skip the Dishes and DoorDash. And we currently have a cell phone. The number is 709-501-4545. You can contact, they can contact the business and stuff for any questions, pre-orders, you know, or bookings as well too, if they would like, for like private caterings and all that stuff.
Right, because you do some catering as well.
Yes.
Yeah, so that phone number, folks, again, is 501-4545.
Yes.
And you're at 302 Water Street, and that's a pretty good location. I don't think you're far from the Merchant Tavern as well. That's pretty close to you.
Yeah.
So, Michael, before we close off, you know, I know you've done a lot of things and this has been quite a big undertaking for you. Yeah, Michael. So I know there's been a lot of logistics that went into opening up this restaurant. But before I go, I want to ask you, like, what did you learn from all of this? And I know you went through a lot. If whatever you want to share with us, take it away.
Well, opening like a restaurant is like very challenging because you need like, you need funds, like no joke. You need to have funds in case like anything was to go wrong, you can cover for it, you know, and, you have to know like a lot of numbers, like what your inventory is, like what you're buying and who you're hiring and all that stuff. And where you're sourcing out, like, you know, your ingredients and all that, just for a restaurant. Perspective, right? Because like you need to have money to start a business. And I got the opportunity with my angel investor, like he believed in me, so through him, like, you know, I got the business there, because I was planning like to go to Alberta and work for like, you know, just half a season and stuff and just come back here and open up my food truck. But I turned that opportunity down just to like have my restaurant on the go. So it's been really great. So you need to have funds is one thing. Another thing too, if you're planning to open up a restaurant, make sure you get your permits and your applications on time and consistently talking to whoever the inspector is for your approval and all that stuff, to have all the legal aspects done as soon as you can. Because like you don't want to wait last minute and you can't operate, then when you're leasing, you know, a restaurant or perhaps a share or a property, it can take a toll on you financially. Like, be honest, like I was shut down for a month and a half because like I didn't hear back from the city and all that stuff, and it was kind of getting to the point that I wanted to give up because I had to pay for rent, I had to pay for insurance, I have to pay for like banking fees and all kinds of stuff. And the food, the inventory that we got, it was starting to go like it was going to waste, and it was a, you know, our burning a hole in our pockets. And it was like a month and a half, man. It was like very devastating. It might not sound nothing for nobody, but me as a young business owner, that like it broke me a lot, man. Like then I had to pay like my own personal like bills and stuff like that, and not generating income, like rent and utilities and like food expenses, gas, traveling and all that stuff, right? So you need to open a business. That's one of the challenges, right? Having everything there, making sure your legal stuff is done properly and all that, and making sure you have the finances as well, just like a plan B backup kind of stuff. That's what I learned. So now I know and I'm prepared for anything now.
Wow, that's a lot, Michael. And for you to have gone through all of that and come out wonderful at the other end. And I want to thank you for opening up the restaurant. I feel we really need it here in the city.
Yeah, and that's what like a lot of people have been telling me that stuff. They're looking for something like, you know, like really different, because as I said before, like same thing with the aspect, like people are looking to try new things. It's not to say like I'm trying to diminish the culture here, like they have the history. I'm not trying to take over that or, you know, say anything negative about that, because I enjoy like Newfoundland food, like jigs dinner is like top tier. But at the same time, like other people, like they want something like new, they want something different, you know, like the generation right now, they're expanding to explore different cultures now. Mm-hmm. So, you know, they want to taste a bit of everything from around the world.
Absolutely. And for Caribbean Corner, what do you have in store for the next few months? I know summer is coming up. St. John's usually have the pedestrian mall. What are some of your plans for the next few months into the summer?
My goal and dream is to have the largest patio or deck on Water Street.
Good.
I'm gonna make that the most festive, like a carnival where people are in like feathers and costumes. I want to make it as much festive. I want to make it like a beach bar and grill, where everything is sanded out. It's very outdoorsy. I want people to feel like they're at the beach. They're comfortable. I know, like walking in shorts and sandals and having a good time, enjoying the sun, having like mixing some marvelous like tropical drinks and all that in the future. And we're going to expand our menu as well.
Yeah.
And we will be hiring more staff, as I want to like be more involved with the community and like generate jobs for everybody. That's one of my goals, opening a business to help out as much people as I can. You never know what somebody is going through in life. I don't care what background they come from, what education they have. If you're willing, you know, to give me 100%, I'm willing to give you my 100%, and I want to help out my community. That's my plans for the summer.
Yeah.
And doing crazy stuff. Yeah.
Absolutely. And hey, look, we want to bring the Caribbean into the city of St. John. So what you just described gave me the feel of being in the Caribbean with the sun and the water and the sand, right? That's fantastic. Go on.
Yeah, so like in the Caribbean, it's like it's like you're always happy just walking on sunshine every day. I mean, we might have rainy days and all that stuff, but like, you know, when you go out to the beach and you have like a nice little like cold drink, it's like really refreshing.
Yes.
And you're just like relaxed, you know.
Absolutely, I know. And speaking of relax, again, we would give the address. You're at 302 Water Street. And so in the summertime, you will be a part of that pedestrian mall area. So people could be walking up and down, come in, sit in your patio, sample one of your nice drinks and one of your delicious dishes. And if they can't make it, we can have them call 501-4545.
Yes.
Right. So, Michael, before we end off, what else would you like to tell us so we can close off on a really nice, positive Caribbean tone? What is it? What do you want to tell the people of St. John's about your restaurant and have them come in? What do you want to say to them?
Well, I want everybody to come in and experience something like different, something vivid, something unique. That's craft every day from scratch. I want everybody just come and try it out. Just have a bite, you know, and just like, I love feedback. I love like, so I could like, you know, build my skill set on a different level and like jack it up and skyrocket it to make sure everybody's like happy, pleased with what they want, right? Because like I'm a people's person and I want to make every show, like every bite that someone has puts a smile on their faces, right? And so like before we go, I just want to give like a big shout out to all my boys at Christian's Bar. that's my favorite bar. I want to give a shout out to the owners of Boca and Cojones for giving me the opportunity. Chef Greg, Chef Mike Clark, Chef Ken Pittman. You have Mark McCrow. You have a bunch of the boys, Chef Chan. Like all these people, like, they taught me so much things. Especially Chef Chan. He's the chef for the convention center. He's top tier. He's shown me a lot of things too. Like all those boys, right? Like, I'm really happy they're part of my life because I learned a lot of things. Very thankful and all that stuff, man. Really am. Yeah, that's pretty much it.
Oh my gosh, that's fantastic. And I'm glad you did that shout out, those shout outs. Thank you for that. That is awesome. So, hey, I want to tell you, we were just so thrilled to have you on the program, Michael, and for taking the time to tell us about your amazing journey, your story, and it's very inspirational. I'm telling you, I was really inspired by it, and I'm sure our listeners are too. And, you know, giving us the motivation that you got to go out on the limb and take those risks. And, you know, I once read Bill Gates said that the greatest risk we take is not taking any risk at all. And you took that risk, and you took a lot of risks, and here you are today. So I want to wish you continued success with Caribbean Corner. And I can't wait to come down and try that oxtail. You have my word.
yes, for sure. Yeah,
I cannot wait. And, you know, you mentioned all these delicious dishes, and a lot of people in the city have traveled, or even in Newfoundland, have gone to the Caribbean. So they know about some of these dishes, the famous jerk chicken, patties, roti, curry. Yeah. So, you know, to add a few things that they're not familiar with, they could only be pleasantly surprised. And like we stated earlier, all the flavors that go into making Caribbean cuisine is awesome.
Yes.
So on behalf of myself and Caribbean Connections, I want to thank you so very much, Michael.
No problem.
So take care of yourself. You're gonna see me in there very soon, and a lot of other people. Okay.
I'm very thankful for the opportunity you have given me today. Not just for the exposure, but just like to getting to know me more, because I feel like a lot of people don't know me very well. But now, man, this is like the best time. I never done this before. So,
we had a good time, didn't we?
Yeah. It was really good. So I really, really happy that like this interview like went well. And living the dream. And thank you so much once again, like, for having me on.
You are most welcome, Michael. It really was my pleasure. And it just sounds like a great restaurant with delicious dishes. And I can't wait to come down and try them all. But I think I'm going to take your advice and try the oxtail for sure.
No problem. Trust me, you'll not regret it.
Oh, no, I know I'm not going to regret it. So thank you again. Good luck with everything that you do. And we'll see each other again, all right?
No problem, miss. Hey, have a nice day.
Yeah, you too. Take care. Have a nice day. Thank you very much for staying with us. And also a big thank you to Michael Collins for sharing his story with us here today on Caribbean Connections. It was an honor. We all had a wonderful time. And I know that Michael did too. So thank you guys, and stick around. We still have another hour of Caribbean Connections coming right up. But for now, let's give it up for Bob and Marcia, Young, Gifted, and Black.
Open your heart to all.
And here's your cricket report. Gudakesh Moti started a tour of Zimbabwe well, almost leading the Windies to a victory in the drawn first test. He then really stepped it up in the second and final test, nullifying the efforts of both the rain and the Zimbabwe batting lineup to secure a win for the West Indies in less than 3 days. In the first innings, pacers Alzari Joseph and a reinvigorated Jason Holder accounted for the first 3 wickets before Moti stepped in with his consistent left-arm spin on a helpful pitch that offered both turn and bounce. Moti's 7 wickets for 37 reduced Zimbabwe to 115 all-out, with the in-form Innocent Kaya, who top-scored with 38 runs, the only batter offering any resistance. 50s from Roston Chase and Raymond Reefer led West Indies to a total of 292. A lead of 177, Victor Nauchi took 5 for 56, and Brandon Mavuta continued his run of form with 3 wickets. Kaya, 43 again, offered resistance to the West Indies bowling attack, but this time he had support from his captain Craig Irvine, who scored 72 runs before becoming the 9 wicket to fall. This time around, all of the bowlers picked up 1 wicket each, except Moti, who once again broke the back of the Zimbabwe batting lineup with 6 wickets for 62 runs. Zimbabwe were eventually dismissed for 173, falling short of making West Indies bat again. The innings and 4-run victory give the Windies a 1-0 series win and continue their undefeated series run against Zimbabwe. Moti's man of the match winning figures of 13 wickets for 99 runs was the best ever match returns by a West Indian spinner, eclipsing Sunny Ramadan's 73-year-old record of 11 for 152. It was also the third best ever bowling performance by a West Indian bowler of any type, just behind Courtney Walsh and Michael Holding.
It's that time again. The biggest party of sport is back. The defending champion is back. TK, are you ready?
East, West, we the champions. North, South, we the champions. All, both, we the champions. So we tell them this, we say. East, West, we the champions. North, South, we the champions. All, both, we the champions. So we tell them this, hey, hey.
Call him Monroe, Dean and Ben,
and Chris Lynn, DKR, this is for you.